Тейлор играл между Fascinating Phenomena of Committee Drift that believes drift back again to the original positive state. So the gist of this paper is that there is a strong correlation between positive illusion, positive mood, and indicators of psychological health. So illusion is healthy, not the other way around. And it's actually depressed people who are low on self-esteem, who are down, which have some realistic estimates about reality and place in it. This is why I said earlier that negative emotions are required for us to orient in reality, because this is also that has been found through experimental psychological research, that it is the depressed and negatively people who have negative affect, negative emotion, who perceive reality realistically. But a normal healthy state is of positive emotion and positive illusion, and cognitive drift is our capacity to return to this positive state. So we have a natural capacity for returning into the healthy state of positive mood and illusion. Mother Nature tries to pull us back into the comfort and safety, perhaps. And law of attraction might be a good outlet for this cognitive drift. It reminds me of a minimally producible example, because it has just these minimal key points, one of which is this positive emotion master switch, of course. And the second key point is to make a wish and put it out there, like in this Pinocchio song, which Jordan Peterson likes to explore. When you wish upon a star, makes no difference who you are, anything your heart desires will come to you. So we have this fairy tale, Morozka, where Santa Claus finds a girl who is freezing, being lost in the forest. And Santa Claus asks the girl, "Are you warm? Do you feel comfortable? Are you warm?" And the girl says, she's freezing, she says, "Yes, grandfather, yes, old guy, I am warm." And it seems a strange answer. It seems a strange answer to me, even now. Telling the story, I kind of have this pause. But it is a kind of empathy or mentalization directed at an external force. So Santa Claus here is an external force. And the girl, she does good by mentalizing, by understanding through her theory of mind that expressing comfort, she will elicit comfort in this old guy, she will elicit sympathy, because she tells him that yes, she's all right, she's comfortable. And the fairy tale compares this with other spoiled children who complain and thus elicit negative emotion in this spirit. So this external force is described in other fairy tales, not just in Morozka, but also in other fairy tales. For example, it is described in Form by Richard Kim. Writer Richard Kim. So in the Form, the protagonist is an alien. He's an alien who comes to a planet as an actor of a intergalactic TV show. And this allows teacher Kim to explore again this connection between a character and the external force. So imagine that you are watching your favorite movie, but at a key moment you can vote for the story to go this way or that way, for a character to be rewarded or punished. Or maybe you can influence a character, make one character successful, or make another character do something risky. In a sense, you while watching this movie, you are the Santa Claus because you decide what happens. You are the miracle. What will happen next is that there will be different TV shows attracting different kinds of audience. So one TV show will be about misery, suffering, pain, loss, or maybe about a catastrophe. Or maybe it's a movie where characters die one after another in a series of small but tragical events. And another TV show might be like a sitcom where people just mingle in a workplace and end up in funny situations, and there is this subtle humor about this entire setup. Or it might be a movie, a TV show about a character who wins one competition after another, makes new enterprises, starts industrial revolutions, ushers a new technological age, you know, so that kind of progressive TV show experience. My point being that there might be very different TV shows attracting different audiences, or else audience in a different mood. And I think that if we would consider, if we would think of how the texture of consciousness is motivated when this consciousness spans both into the microcosm and into the macrocosm, into the spirits which are hidden somewhere inside a body or hidden somewhere outside, in a culture, in a language, in some unknown resonances, unknown to modern science, but traceable nevertheless. If you consider the tapestry of this consciousness and what motivates it, then comparing them to audiences of television shows might be a good way to make a point. The point, likely, is that the interaction between the character and the TV show they ended up in inspires the audience towards different outcomes. And the audience can, in turn, decide what the fate of the character or the reality around them will be. So David Snyder, at the end of the video, points out that confidence is largely a lie, and that what we need actually is for people to be relentless in their pursuits. But Taylor E. Brown, of course, have shown to us that there is a direct connection between the illusion, the positive illusion such as confidence, and the relentlessness. So it is people who maintain this positive illusion which become relentless. And by being relentless, by being proactive, they become a character which factors more into the show and can attract some miracles, should we say, from the audience. So the probability of the audience influencing the show in a way favorable to the character in one way or another is better simply because the character is always trying to do something silly, maybe, and happens often in these new and unusual situations, and being charismatic. Because should we say that a charismatic person is a person who is stubborn in pursuing something, like they push their personality a bit onto the audience and onto the reality of the show. like a monk, perhaps. I think that his personality pushes a bit around against the environment, pushes outwards in a charming way, of course. I mean, there are different kinds of charms. So, anti-hero might be charming. And, the charm is a bit about moderation, right? So finding the right amount and combination of traits to inspire the audience, which is the tapestry of cognition out there. And Snyder mentions also something to that effect, that people would often battle between the identity that was imprinted by society on them and the identity that they want. So when they do this battle, when they push the character outwards, they become an interesting character, and this might be a key in the law of attraction, which might be a strange thing to say, but we can frame it in different terms. For example, Boyd in Organic Design mentions this importance of going external, the environment selects. So if you're going external, we're increasing the probability of success. And the law of attraction invites us to go external into this tapestry of consciousness. It doesn't specify what this externality is. It invites us rather to believe in the universe and the world, so sharing our wish with the universe. And it's good enough, because any piece of it can be this external piece. Which we are communicating with, sometimes even unknownly to us, sometimes knownly, sometimes unknownly. So I think that the law of attraction is right and correct in not specifying this externality in some narrow terms, but rather leaving it blank, leaving it a clean star. So, but it invites a person to share his wish out and to trust that something will return from the outside. Something positive will return from the outside. So it fosters this relationship with the external. So the second key to law of attraction is that it invites a person to wish upon a star and to enter into a positive interaction with the external. In the tapestry of consciousness, it helps a character to inspire or discover the audience.